Welcome to Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University. I am Bobby Gempsa, president of St. John's. It is rare that a university can point to one individual as the embodiment of both its mission and its proud athletic tradition. At St. John's, we have that privilege. His name is Lou Carnaseca, and he is simply known as Coach. A member of the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame and exemplary university ambassador, Lou has been part of St. John's since his first head coaching stint in 1965. He spent 24 seasons as head coach of St. John's men's basketball program and reached the postseason in every one of them. He built winning teams, but more importantly, he mentored fine young men who learned the value of hard work, integrity, and service as dedicated student athletes. Stay with us for a conversation with Lou Carnaseca, a man known worldwide both for his coaching and, more importantly, his passion for St. John's and its Catholic and Vincentian mission when we return to Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University. Thank you for joining us and sharing knowledge with our guest, Coach Lou Carnaseca. Coach, you graduated from St. John's in 1950. My first question is, how did you get the opportunity to come back and start your coaching career here at St. John's?
Let me say, the first time I saw St. John's play, 1942. In those days, we would play preliminary games to the, let's say, to the college games, and at night, they would give you tickets to come and see the game. And I can still remember seeing this big Redmond team run out there with big guys, Boy Cuff, Ike Godkin, Fuzzy Levine, all the great, great stars. And I fell in love with them. 1942.
Wow.
Then, of course, I came back in 47. I started.
Did you start just by helping the team informally as a student?
There were the coaches there, both Coach Frank McGuire and Joe Lapchick would allow me to come in because I was a terrible player. I was not a good player. But I love basketball. And I would love to come in, referee the scrimmages, come in and watch them play and just listen to what they had to say. At halftime in the games, they would allow me to take notes. It was a marvelous, marvelous apprenticeship for me. And that was the start for me. I got involved with basketball.
Do you remember your first game as a head coach?
How can I forget it? We got beat by the freshman team. It was Thanksgiving, and we always played the freshman team just before the Thanksgiving holidays. And that day they beat us, and they beat us. It wasn't a fluke. I remember for 3 days, I didn't eat, I didn't sleep or anything. But it was a great lesson. I had given them too much to do. I had really worked them too hard, and there was nothing left. But it was a great lesson.
Over your 24-year tenure as head coach here at St. John's, you had an amazing run. I mean, you went to postseason in each of those years. But for those of us, I was a graduate student at Penn State at that time when 1985 team came about.
Yes, you know, everyone talks about the 85 team, but St. John's always had great teams. Going back to the late 20s, the 1-5. And then with Joe Lapchick, we had a great run. Coach Frank McGuire went to the finals and got beat by Kansas for the NCAA championship. Then, of course, later on, Joe Lapchick came back again and another run. And then, of course, I started and I just followed what they did, their plan, their system, going back to Buck Freeman, who probably was the greatest coach St. John's ever had.
Now, at that time, we didn't have internet. It was all print newspaper. But you were still at the sports pages, literally.
You know, a big thing about that, I started with a lot of these writers. I started in high school, and they were writing high school sports. So there was a familiarity, and they were kind in their remarks. But St. John's always proved themselves, always comported themselves well. It was a known quantity.
Now, your 1989 team won the NIT championship. And you were...
Yes, I have the watch right here.
There you go. And you spoke about the miracle of St. John's. And you share with us what that miracle was. You still remember?
Really? When you look at St. John's, a little school started out in Brooklyn. Okay? Not a big university. Months of, you know, campus. But what it was a working class school. Most of the people that went to St. John's at that time would go to class and then go work at night. They became lawyers, doctors, teachers, education, any enforcement. It was a local school which turned out people that were good workers. That ethic was made it so good. And basketball was part of it. They followed the same thing. And we had the old St. John's at Lewis Avenue. The cafeteria, three steps, and there was the gym, mm-hmm. the gray. So that everybody could come in and watch us practice. They knew the players who they read about, coaches who they saw on TV in those days, or maybe they saw newspaper clippings. There was the familiarity. Basketball was part of our tradition. I can remember going to the garden. Behind St. John's bench, up in the stands would be 50, 60 Vincentians. It looked like the Supreme Court up there. And they loved basketball. It was always part. And it came from the top. The president wanted good basketball. He wanted that. And it did help us. Because you know what it does? You're playing teams, great universities, and now you beat them. Well, now you must be a somebody. And that's some, you know, little team. If you can do that, it means you have some character. You have done a good job. And that was the St. John's. We had a great tradition.
You know, good teams, excellent teams, outstanding teams start with outstanding, good, and excellent recruitment.
You can't play without them. That's the number one part. Buck Freeman, as I say, I mentioned his name. I was at Camp All America, which we'd go to every summer. And I said, Coach, if you had a measuring rod from 1 to 100, how would you divide it between coaching, players, refereeing, all that? He says, Lou, players are between 65 and 70%. Now, being a young coach, that floored me. I thought we were much more important than that. And he said, no, coaching, 15, 20%. And then he said, don't forget the 5% luck. When that ball bounces, sometimes it goes in, and sometimes it bounces out. And to this day, that's an excellent measurement. It's still true.
Stay with us for a conversation with Lou Carnaseca, a man known worldwide, both for his coaching and, more importantly, his passion for St. John's and its Catholic and Vincentian mission, when we return to Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University.
Hi, I'm Kristen Gretto, a senior and member of the St. John's University dance team. The dance team captured first place in the Division I hip-hop category at the 2016 UCA and UDA College Cheerleading and Dance Team National Championship.
Welcome back to Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University. I am joined today by Coach Lou Carnaseca. Lou, we were talking about the 1985 team. Share with us the experience on how you developed that team, how you made that run, and what was the pressure and the challenge that you had to face during that year?
Number one, and this is, I'm not trying to belittle motherhood. My mother could have coached that team. And why do I say that? Because of the makeup, because the way they got along with each other. I can tell you there's a little story, this is true. It's just before Christmas, and we had a game coming up. So we were practicing, trying to get ready. And God Almighty, these guys, they want to play, fooling around, you know, missing shots, bad passes. I finally got so upset, get out of the gym. And I chased them out. Practice is over. I go into the office. All of a sudden, there's a knock on my door. There's the manager. He says, Coach, come out and take a look out here. See what's happening. I go out there. The whole team is going through the practice as if I was there. Much better than if I ever could run that play. But they knew how to play. And they were all local fellas. They had played against each other in high school, in the summer leagues. So there was a familiarity. It was really a team that was, people could say, it was made in heaven. You know, the coaching was very simple. You didn't have to explain, just this is what I want, and they did it, and they played well. But that team came slowly. It was a good team in 82, 83, tough, 84, start 85. So for that area, these fellas had played a lot together and knew each other. And to be honest, there's only one person that stopped us, and that's Patrick Ewing. And we won it all. People expected us
to win it
to
all.
Be good. We had to win. We had to win. We knew it, the players knew it, everybody. It was New York team. For some reason, I think it's because most of the players were from New York. They had known them in high school in the CYO, PAL. So there was a great familiarity with that. And now we get them at St. John's, and they're good. Holy mackerel. I mean, they could have run for mayor. It was such a popular team. It was New York's team. As a matter of fact, even today, walking down the street, even here on Union Turnpike, hey, that was some team you guys had. They still remember it, you know? But we've had great teams before that. But they remember that team because of the makeup of the players.
So what you're really saying is that you can't build a team overnight. You have to build the foundation, the core.
It doesn't come overnight, you're right. It takes a while and patience. But you got to start out with good players and hope good people.
So when you recruited players at that time, you obviously had to explain what St. John's University was all about.
Doctor, we didn't have to do it. They knew us.
Oh, they knew.
I mean, St. John's was a known quantity because they had seen us play here at the Alumni Hall then. Mm-hmm. They'd seen us play in the Garden. We were a known quantity. We couldn't dazzle anybody with tricks. That's why we got so many transfers. They would go away, and then maybe that grass wasn't that green. And they would come back. Every year we got one or two players back. And that really helped us because they knew St. John's. They wanted to give it a shot out there and said, it's not what we thought it would be. New York knew St. John's.
Now today, what has changed in the recruitment landscape? Okay,
first of all, the recruiting. I mean, I could recruit 5 minutes from now, jump on a subway, jump on a bus. Today you have to go all over the country. Now what they do, if you're a good player, when you're a freshman or sophomore, they get you and put you in a prep school. They put you in the icebox for you. And then they recruit you and they have the seniors. Well, we had all those kids. We knew them. We didn't get them all. We didn't want them all. We would like to have them. But all we want is a couple every year. And that's what it, that was a success. We always got 2-3 players. That one here, a big Z, and Felipe Lopez. They were New York products. And why go out of town when we have good players here? Plus, you know that kid. You've seen him play in high school. You've seen him play in the CYO. You have a pretty good book, not only as a player, but how about his character? How about his attitude? Now, we didn't get all saints, but at least you started off with knowledge how to handle.
Now, have you noticed a change in the size, the speed, the athleticism of the game?
God, to me, I guess today, the way these kids play, everything looks slow-mo then. They can jump higher, they can run faster, have more moves. Today, it's more of a solo. At that time, it was an ensemble, if I can put it in that scheme of things. In those days, you know, you played more together, more team concept. Today, don't take the ball out of bounds, because you may never get it again. The game has changed. And it's become more individualistic. Well, at that time, it was more of a composition.
Let's talk about one major change in the game of basketball. About 30 years ago, 1986, 1987, the three-point shot was introduced. And that was towards, what, the last 6-7 years of your coaching career.
I'm glad you brought that up. First of all, it makes a big man, from a little guy, can be better than a big man. You notice today, it's not a big man's game. It's become more guard-oriented because of the three-point play. I mean, you can, it's a home run with the bases loaded. You can be out of the ball game with maybe 10 points with 3 or 4 minutes, and you can win the ball game. It's a wonderful thing. It's excitement. People love it. It keeps you on edge. It's really changing. And really, that was an influence from Europe. That came from them, especially the Yugoslavian teams, who were great shooters, and the Russian teams. So in that sense, it's made the game much more exciting. Plus, remember the clock. Going way back, even before my time, if you took a shot and missed, you wouldn't see the ball for a month. The great team that Coach Lapsik called and Coach Buck Freeman coached, the Wonder Five. They had to put the 10-second line on the court because in those days, you could throw the ball from back court to front court. There was no clock. So you could go to sleep with that ball. The game has changed. It's much more quicker. More with the times. As our cars got faster, our players are getting faster.
Every time I go watch a game at the Madison Square Garden, there's a big picture of you and John Thompson wearing the sweater. How did the sweater become part of your legacy?
Well, let me tell you, I know John since he was in high school, played against my St. Anne's team.
Oh, I see.
See, I go way back with him. Matter of fact, Coach Lapsik sent me down to recruit him, but his mother was afraid to send him to St. John's because it was New York. I thought New York was a tough city. I said, he's 6'10". Nobody's going to bother him, you know? But see, that's how we got to know each other. And of course, then he got the job. And we had great rivalries, great games.
I am told that one of your memorable victories was when St. John's played the Soviet Union national team. Do you remember that game?
Oh, yes. You mean the Russian team?
Yes.
Of course, thank God it was played at Alumni Hall. I can remember, still today, we're down 1 point with about 7-8 seconds to go. Tachenko, who was 7'3", he had a head that was that big. I don't know how the poor fellow put that on the pillow. I really don't know, okay? He's going to the face, the game is over. He's going to make the foul shots, no doubt about it. He goes up, takes the shot, choom, makes it. 2 points. The referee says, no good. Over the line. Other way. We get the ball in bounds, goes down to Bernard Rencher, lets one go at the buzzer, and we beat them. Komelski, who was the coach of the Russian team, chased the two referees down Union Turnpike. And when he came back, I says, do you think I would have won that game in Moscow? It was one of the great games of
With that, we'll take a short break and be right back.
Hi, I'm Kevin Torres. I'm a senior on the St. John's baseball team. This year, St. John's student-athletes won both Big East Male and Female Student-Athlete of the Year awards. Close to 90% of St. John's student-athletes carry above a 3.0 GPA or better.
Welcome back to Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University. I am joined by Coach Lou Carnaseca. Lou, if you remember the very recent past, that day was April 1 last year. And during that time, we announced that Chris Mullen would become the new head coach of St. John's University. Share with us your thoughts on that day.
I felt very proud and honored to have one of our guys And of course, Chris was always a favorite son here at St. John. People remember him. But to see him come back and coach gave us a lift. And I think that'll make us proud in the future. It'll take time, as you said, but I think he's doing a good job recruiting, getting players, and he'll start building the foundation, all things that you mentioned.
I clearly remember that day. I haven't participated in a press conference of a similar nature when I counted there were probably 12 television cameras in the arena.
It was very good.
And there was no basketball game at that time.
But you know, Chris was a very popular player. I mean, he's homebrew. I mean, he was born in the ground here. Brooklyn kid, played in the CYO in a Catholic high school. Catholic College, St. John's, and he's one of their own.
So if you were to make a forecast, what do you think is the future direction of St. John's basketball?
Oh, I think we're going in the right direction. The foundation is being built. We're getting players. This year was a learning situation for everybody. But it's getting some good players, and with that will come victories. Not going to come overnight. As we say, Rome wasn't built in a day. But I like what he's doing with the recruits. Very happy with that. He's working them hard. Now, last year, maybe they didn't have all the attributes of some of our former teams, but they never quit. They worked hard. And that's a good ingredient. If you do that, you keep hitting that stone, you're going to crack it.
You know, one of the other things I remember that day was when you gave Chris Mullin a card which says, Peacock today, feather duster tomorrow. Not too many people caught that, the significance of you handing that card to him.
I can tell you about that. Coach Slapshick gave it to me. This was, had to be 1968. I had the coach of the year for that year and was celebrated. That was a big thing in the pros and the colleges. We'd have this great feast together. After the ceremony, we went down to Danny's Hideaway, which was an excellent restaurant on the east side in Second Avenue. So we're at the bar, everybody's talking, all of a sudden, Coach Slapshick says, Camilo, I want you to have this. So I take and I look at it. Peacock today. Feather duster tomorrow. He says, put this in your wallet and never take it out. And the first time I took it out was when I gave it to Chris. Wow. At that. I was worn and tired, but it was there. Same thing with that, okay? To talk about, you think you're pretty good? My head was pretty big. Jack Gimmel, who was our trainer, goes over to the hat check girl. He says, do you know who that is? No, that's Conosecca. That's the grocery store that sells all the Italian salami. Made my head shrink like a peanut. So that card came into play right away. Put me right down to earth.
Now that Chris Mullin has 1 year under his belt coaching the team, do you have one piece of advice you'd like to share with our current coach?
The first thing, have patience. Don't get down. It's a learning process. And keep working the way you've been doing. Keep recruiting. Keep your staff together. These are all important things. Keep your players together. Stay on top of them. They'll work out fine. They will. Because they're working hard. I've been at a couple of practices. There's nobody fooling around. Which is good ingredients to start with. You need those principles.
As a Hall of Fame coach, what would you like your career to be remembered for?
The old coach, that's all. It's simply that. Who had good players.
Let's talk about the university's Vincentian mission, which is in every facet in the life of the campus at St. John's.
You know, something and I talk about it an awful lot years ago. You know, we don't not only got moral, ethical lessons in a theology class or the philosophy. We got it in the English class, in the history class. It was part of our tradition. We got it. Nobody shoved it down your throat. Just part of it. The men that were up in front of that class teacher, out of five professors, I had three Vincentians. Always, to college. And constantly, the example was there. Now, if you wanted to listen. And matter of fact, I think the people that came out of that group, and not to say not the others either, were wonderful men. Most of us had come back from World War II. But we understood. We were a little older, and we understood what these principles were. It's not going to be your way all the time. You can't be number one. And work and help other people. Give of yourself. And when you do that, you do things for yourself.
And my final question for you, as you may know, many of our St. John's alum are watching the show. Do you have a message for them?
Cheer up. Better days ahead.
Thank you very much. As we close today, I want to thank the incomparable coach Lou Carneseca for sharing his memories, his basketball insights, and his love for St. John's with us on Sharing Knowledge, presented by St. John's University. We will see you next time.